Grace to you and peace from God our Father and our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Years ago, before television and radio were in existence, the newspaper was the primary method of getting the news out to the public. And when newspapers were in their heyday, they would print the paper and get it out onto the street. But if something big were to happen after the printing was done and after the paper was delivered, the publisher would print an extra copy of the news. And then the paper boys would take that extra down to the street corner, and he would set his stack there on the corner, and he'd shout out, "Extra, extra, read all about it." That way, everyone would know they need to come and buy a new copy of the paper to find out what the latest news was that was hitting the streets. Well, technology brought television and radio, and in today's world, we have the news delivered to us 24/7 in real time. You may recall the Gulf War back in the 80s. We could see each move of the war played out in real time right there on CNN. You could watch it as it all unfolded. Some 40, 50 years ago, you may have had your TV show or radio program interrupted by the news. Say, Walter Cronkite coming on, telling us that President Kennedy had been assassinated. Or in the 60s, late 60s, you may have heard Neil Armstrong's first words from the moon as he stepped foot upon the moon, "One small step for man, one giant leap for mankind." When we think of all those famous announcements over the years and the impact that it had on the hearers of the day, be it the bombing of Pearl Harbor, which the history of that was just anniversary was celebrated yesterday, or is it a high-dollar sports contract painting the newspaper with his new contract, millions of dollars that he's going to get? All these top news articles that we hear today pale. They don't hold up a bit compared to the announcement that was made to that 15-year-old girl some 2,000 years ago, the virgin in the city of Nazareth. It wasn't made by a news announcer, no Walter Cronkite, no Larry King, no Rush Limbaugh existed of the day. It was a messenger from God. The messenger's name was Gabriel. Gabriel, sent from God, brought that message to the virgin. As we read in the gospel earlier, in the sixth month, the angel Gabriel was sent from God to a city of Galilee named Nazareth to a virgin betrothed to a man whose name was Joseph of the house of David. And the virgin's name was Mary. He came to her and said, "Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you." Now, Gabriel is one of two angels listed in the Bible that we have as our canonical Bible. Gabriel means champion of God. Gabriel was God's messenger. He's mentioned twice in the Old Testament. Each time mentioned in the book of Daniel, he was giving Daniel wisdom and understanding on dreams. Gabriel, interestingly enough, is mentioned also twice in the New Testament. And both times in the New Testament, he's making an announcement of birth. The first announcement was the birth of John the Baptist. He made that announcement to Zechariah, a doubting Zechariah, who knew that his barren wife, Elizabeth, there was no way possible she could have a child. He doubted Gabriel's words. The second example of the announcement was in our gospel lesson read earlier. Now, if you or I were to have made this announcement, we probably would have spared no expense going to the public forum and announcing it publicly, shouting from the mountaintops, "Favored are you, O chosen one." We would have made sure everybody was there so they could hear that announcement and so they could marvel at this wonderful, blessed event that was about to take place. But we weren't in charge. God was. God's ways are not our ways. God's plan was that this announcement would be made humbly to that young girl in Nazareth. Nazareth, a city that was, well, it was really more of a village. It wasn't even on the main path. There was not a main road going through the country that went through Nazareth. People were despised at the thought of Nazareth. They would rather forget about the town Nazareth. You may recall Nathanael's sarcastic remark to Philip, "Can anything good come out of Nazareth?" But that's where God decided to plant the Holy Spirit, plant that seed. We also notice in Luke, he writes in repetition in verse 27. He uses the word virgin twice in one verse, the repetition to emphasize the importance. He says, a virgin betrothed. Later in the verse, the virgin's name was Mary. He didn't want anyone to miss out on this one small, significant instance. The fact that Mary was a virgin, well, that in itself is big news. How could that be possible, that a virgin could give birth? Mary wasn't adopting a son. Mary wasn't going to stroll along the river and pick a basket out like Moses was found floating in the River Nile. In our day, Mary was not having in vitro fertilization. She was being fertilized. The Holy Spirit was conceiving the child in her womb, the womb of a 15-year-old girl. This child was to be true God and true man. In Gabriel's announcement to her, he not only was revealing great news to Mary, but he was bringing comfort to her as well. He said, "Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you." And at that moment, Mary didn't realize that she was the one who had been prophesied about 700 years earlier in Isaiah, where we read, "Behold, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and shall call his name Emmanuel." Emmanuel. The name Emmanuel means God with us. Just as Gabriel told Mary, the Lord is with you. Tonight, here in Shum, Ohio, we have confidence that the Lord is with us as well. This baby, Jesus, born in a stable, suffered and died, rose from the grave, ascended into heaven. He's with us too, this very evening. And thanks be to God that He is with us. Because we really, really need Him. The media that I spoke of earlier, every day the media brings us lots of news, lots of bad news, be it news of greed, rape, murder, all kinds of bad news. Some forms of the media brings visuals to our minds that cause us to sin, that plant seeds of greed in our hearts, or sinful thoughts. But it's not the media's fault. The media has nothing to do with our sinful world. It's only a symptom of a much larger problem. And all we have to do is look in the mirror to see the root of that sin. We were born into sin, and the Bible tells us so. God's law proves it, that we are sinful. Upon hearing Gabriel's words, Mary was greatly troubled at the saying from the angel, and she tried to discern what sort of a greeting this was. In discerning, she asked herself, what does this mean? We being good Lutherans, going through confirmation, after we say each of the Ten Commandments, we say, what does this mean? We should fear and love God, on and on. But do we really fear, love, and trust in God above all things? Probably not. Do we fear and love God so that we do not tell lies about our neighbor, betray him, slander him? Or do we help him out and speak well of him and explain everything in the kindest way? Probably not. No, definitely not. There's no way possible that in this sinful body we can keep the law of God. The Apostle Paul says, "Wretched man who I am, who will deliver me from this body of death?" We too are wretched. Our sinful beings dying in this desolate world. There's nothing we can do to escape this sinful body on our own. It is beyond us. There's nothing at all we can do. But we can find comfort in Gabriel's words. Those words Gabriel shared with the Virgin that night. Greetings, O favored one, the Lord is with you. We too are favored by God. God looked upon us with his grace and sent that little one, conceived by the Holy Spirit, into the Virgin's womb, and she named him Jesus. Jesus meaning Savior, Emmanuel. God is with us. Further on in our gospel, he will be great and he will be called the Son of the Most High. And the Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over the house of Jacob forever, and his kingdom there will be no end. This announcement's huge. It's greater than announcing the end of a war. It's greater than who won the World Series or the Super Bowl. It is a huge announcement. This is the introduction of the promise to King David that King David's throne will go on rule in eternity. It is the promise that God made to Eve back in the Garden of Eden, where God told Eve that her seed would crush the head of the serpent. It is the culmination of that promise. In his defeating Satan, the death and the grave, by faith in this baby Jesus, we have found favor. Be it undeserved favor, God has favor upon us. We have that promise, the promise of the forgiveness of sins, and the promise of life everlasting. God fulfilled prophecy, every bit of the prophecy of the Old Testament, in bringing Jesus to the earth to die and show us his favor. Going from manger to grave, rising, and then sitting on the right hand of the Father on the throne, God's kingdom will have no end. Our media, it can certainly lead us astray as it plants those ideas in our head, but we were sinful already. Sometimes we don't know whether to believe what we hear or not in the media. And when we read this gospel lesson tonight, it reads just like a tabloid at the grocery store. Think about it. Extra, extra, read all about it. 15-year-old virgin to give birth to the Savior of the world. It seems preposterous. It seems impossible. It seems too good to be true. But it is true because God promised us in his holy word. How about this headline? Extra, extra, read all about it. God sends his greetings to the saints of St. Thomas and Zion. O favored ones, the Lord is with you. May the God of hope fill you with all the joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit, you may abound in hope. Amen.